Mark Odom's 3D dosimetry lab. And then I was lucky enough to continue working on some of the analysis here at Wofford throughout the semester. It started with a recent graduate of the Duke program, Scott Hoopengartner, who did more of a proof of concept, and then I was able to take that and apply it to some complex applications. So before we get into my project, we need to understand what exactly is radiation therapy as well as dosimetry. So radiation therapy, or RT, uses ionizing radiation to kill cancerous cells. So ionizing radiation is part of the electromagnetic spectrum, and as you can see, it's just more energetic light. And once we have this high energy light, we can, which are gamma rays, we can strip the electrons off of atoms, and we're breaking bonds. And anytime we do that, the cells can't repair at a rate that can help the cell survive. Therefore, it also happens in cancerous cells as well as healthy tissues. So we want to be very specific in where we target. And that leads me to dosimetry, which is the measurement or calculation of that radiation dose at that place. Now, before we get to my project, it's also important to note the trend in therapy over the last 30 years. So as you can see, we've gotten a lot better at sparing some of the healthy tissues while still being extremely conformal to the tumor targets. And that's attributed to some extremely complex deliveries of the radiation beams, such as SRS or stereotactic radiosurgery. But in order to apply these extremely complex deliveries, we need more accurate treatment planning systems, and that's where my work came in. So the current radiation therapy procedure, if you were unfortunately diagnosed with cancer, you have a diagnostic CT, computed tomography, or PET scan, in which the dosimetrist will go in, they will circle the tumors, as well as the organs at risk they would like to spare, because it's healthy tissue. From there, they will send it off to the radiation oncologist, who will form a treatment plan to eradicate the tumor, and this goes through some very complex algorithms to optimize the plan. But once they're happy with that, they will go ahead and test the plan. They do this during a quality assurance simulation, but unfortunately that's done in two dimensions currently using gaschromic and radiochromic films. So at this time, that's the best technology we have. So they sign off on the plan and you receive your radiation treatment. But as you can see, everything else here is done in three dimensions, but the quality assurance simulation is in 2D. So that's where my project looked to aim to find a solution to. So our solution came in the ClearView 3D radiochromic dosimeter. This is it pictured to the right. And how these things work is the same way as the 2D radiochromic and gaschromic films, except we installed it into a gel that we can form a volume in. So in this case, a radiation beam is sent down the central axis, and the more color change you observe, which we call the change in optical attenuation, is associated with a higher radiation dose. So at the top, it's darker than the bottom, and then the sides are almost clear, meaning there's little or no radiation in these regions. So after we have irradiated the dosimeter, we need a way to scan it so we can compare it to the treatment plan that we predicted in the dose. We do that using the Duke Large Field of View Optical CT Scanner, or DLOS. Now, a typical CT that you might receive in the hospital would actually use x-rays to image your body. Now, we have already irradiated this dosimeter, and we don't want to invalidate our results, so we actually use visible light. So we send visible light through a series of optical lenses through the dosimeter to, or in this case, our two targets, two tumor targets, and then into a camera. Now, this is in two-dimensional. It's just two-dimensional. But we can spin the dosimeter, and using that 360-degree view, we can form a 3D model with some complex computer image processing. Now that brings me to my project. I've done a few different experiments with different types of irradiations, but for the purpose of this presentation, we'll just look at the two target experiment. So the dosimeter in this case would mimic the brain, and these are two brain lesions that we're trying to target. Going over the procedure one more time, we would generate a two target treatment plan using Eclipse, which is software. Then we deliver that radiation to the dosimeter. We scan the irradiated dosimeter with the DLOS that we just discussed. And then that brings me to my project, which is running the analysis using a software called 3D Slicer. And from there, we use a figure of merit called 3D gamma analysis, and we can extract line profiles, both of which we will discuss here. So before we go on, it's important to make the distinction between a pixel and a voxel. You're probably familiar with a pixel, which is just like on your television screen, which is in two dimensions. A voxel is the same concept, but it forms a volume in three dimensions. So our goal or aim here is to compare the predicted dose from the treatment planning system to the measured dose that we scanned in the dosimeter. But at both of these scans and predicted dose, we have two types of data. We have spatial data, which is just where you are within the dosimeter, as well as a dose value associated at that specific voxel. So we have two different sets of data. We need to combine them into one value that we can then compare across the two scans. We do that using a figure of merit, the gamma analysis. So we need to calculate a gamma value. It turns out this is extremely complex, so I'm going to try to attempt to explain it to you in two-dimensional using a pixel, but what we did was a 3D voxel gamma analysis. So for the simplified version, in 2D, you have two spatial dimensions and then a dose axis. Before we get into the figure, the DTA is a distance to agreement, so that's just where you are on one pixel versus the other, for the predicted dose versus the measured dose. And through this equation, we come up with a gamma value, and we select criteria that we'd like to test it against. In this case, D is representative of the percent difference between the predicted and measured dose. So this would be a 3% difference in the doses within a 3 millimeter range that you're searching between the pixels. So if we apply this to a graph, what we can see is the red circle is the spatial component. So a 3 millimeter range that we're looking for on the x and y axes. And then the dose comparison, the percent difference in doses, is on, in this case, what would be the z axis. And this forms a volume or ellipsoid. And what we're trying to do is compare the measured dose to the predicted dose. And if the measured dose is within the volume of the predicted dose, this ellipsoid, then we pass. That's what we want. If it's outside, like it is in this case, then the gamma fails at this point. So it just so happens that if you run the math, the surface of this ellipsoid volume is 1. Therefore, gamma values greater than 1 fail, while less than 1 pass. Now, we do this actually in 3Ds because we're adding the z component of our spatial data. It's almost impossible to model the four-dimensional data that we can comprehend, so I just left the graph blank, but this is what the computer is doing in this case. So we receive a 3D gamma map looking something like this. In order to get the gamma pass rate, we take the number of passing voxels divided by the total number of voxels to get our gamma value, in this case, which is 96.92%, which is really good. And again, greater than 1 fails, less than 1 passes, and you can see we do get some kind of spatial information as to where we passed and where we failed in which voxels. It's also important to note that on this last screen, I showed one calculation, but this calculation is being repeated over 100,000 times. So that kind of proves the computational power that we need to perform this analysis. So the results of this two target delivery were extremely good. As you see on the x-axis, we have decreasing criteria, so that's that ellipsoid getting smaller and smaller for the volume. But even down to our most strict criteria of 2% 2 millimeters, we're well above the minimally accepted value for clinical and hospital applications at the current time, which is really promising. Now, in addition to the gamma analysis, we also can extract line profiles. So how this image would be interpreted is if we start down here on the black arrow moving across, that is represented by the line graph moving left to right. So you can see our first tumor here is represented here, second with B on the right side. Now, in the line graph to the right, in green we have the measured dose from the clear view that we scanned on the dosimeter, and we're comparing that to the predicted dose from the ECLIPSE treatment planning system. As you can see, it's very conformal across both of the tumors, which is really nice, but what I think is even more impressive is if you look at the distances between, the distance between these tumors that we can raise the value from 45 gray all the way down to 10, so that's less than 20% of the maximum distance, is smaller than a quarter. So the distance between those two tumors is the size of a quarter, which is quite impressive. So in conclusion, the current radiation therapy procedure uses a quality assurance simulation that is done in two dimensions using gaschromic and rheochromic films. This can lead to some inaccuracies in the treatment planning process and delivery, so we look to try to change that. And we found a potential piece that fits the puzzle that is in three dimensions, which is the ClearView 3D radiochromic dosimeters. This can lead to improved patient outcomes as well as increased confidence that we're delivering the radiation that the treatment plan is predicting. Thank you.
Any questions for Andrew?
So what's the next step? What happens with the
Now we're looking to validate our results. So I'm still working with, I actually trained up the girl that is replacing me on the same software, and the company Modus QA that makes the dosimeters has agreed to train her on their new software called VistaAce. So we're gonna upload our data that we already have from our scanners into their system and compare the results, as well as the DLOS that we have. They have agreed to send a different optical CT scanner to do to repeat the experiment to hopefully validate their results.
That's fabulous.
Any other questions? Go ahead.
Why is it that the current like quality assessment is in 2D while everything else is in 3D? Is the technology like that much more advanced for that specific?
That's what I was shocked too to find out that everything's in three dimension. That's really the problem is we're trying to model 3D tumors with 2D films. There's just some sort of inaccuracy there. So that's what we're trying to replace.
That was kind of my question. So does no doctors or companies use 3D testing?
So there's actually one other company that makes, I believe it's called Prestige Dosimeters. But across the board, it's not applied to the clinic. There's some issues that they're trying to work through. I mean, not every clinic has an optical CT like this or the DVOS that I explained. That's an expensive piece of equipment. Not every clinic has it. And then they even discussed, well, we'll ship you the dosimeter. You can do your experiment and then ship it back to us, and we will scan it on our CT. But then you run into issues in shipping where there could be radiation that affects the dosimeter in shipping when it runs through like an X-ray machine. So they really haven't found a perfect solution. They need to, in my opinion, they need to figure out how they can almost freeze the dosimeter after it has been scanned. And I think that's probably the next step.
Any other questions? All right, thank you.